Hey y'all, we're at our Sportsman's Banquet, Calvary Baptist Church, 2019. Let me show you a little bit of stuff. They just prayed, the guys are in line getting their food. The decorations on the table. Got a little slideshow going on. I don't know if that's gonna show up. There's Benjamin's first deer ever. How cool was that? You got some nice mounts up here. Empty shelves. Here's our giveaways. Muzzleloader, fishing rods, multi-tools, all kind of gift cards right there. Bags, stuff, some more deer heads. Oh, look at that bass over there. That's Benjamin's first deer. That's the one that was on the video. Look at that bass. There's my deer. I think this might be, that might be Ryan's first deer ever. How about that? There's one of Eric's camouflage skull. That's pretty good. There's our guy still cooking in the kitchen. What's up, fellas? How y'all doing? We got our dessert table over here. Guys are coming. You're fine. You're fine.
You're supposed to have something.
Fish. Oh, fish. Turkey. Your rice. Fish. Charter sauce and your
cupcake sauce. What's going on, buddy? What's going on, buddy?
Shotguns and his.
Good crowd in there. We've already been outside. It was raining all morning. Set up in the rain. We got our skeet shooting going. Had a little competition out there. Shot some 22s, 410, 20 gauge, 12 gauge. Had another station. Was working bows. Did some bow shooting. I don't know how that went. And they had a little golf area outside. We've had a good time. We'll eat now. And we'll go ahead and listen to a good word of the Lord. Stay tuned, we'll see y'all.
The cooking contest, and the food was outstanding. Anybody here have the smoked barracuda today?
Amen, that was delicious.
First time it's ever made it into this meeting, and the first time ever made it into my mouth. It was good, very, very good all the way through. And we're going to give some of these things. We have all that ready for those guys, Brother Caleb?
Yes, sir.
All right, I'm glad Brother Caleb's here. I have no idea what to do except talk. And so I'll just keep talking until we get it together. Let's recognize the folks in the cooking contest. Brother Ian helped us with that. Where are you at, Brother Ian? God bless you, buddy. Thank you for putting all that together. We have some trophies, I think, for those guys. Where are those? Do we have those up here, Brother Ian? We have those trophies. Very good. And we're going to get those out here in just a moment. And let's see. Third place here with our cooking contest with deer tacos. It's going to go to Mr. Walker Boyd. Mr. Walker Boyd, how about that? Very good, Walker. And interestingly enough, we've got Deer Chili in second place with Kaylee Boyd. Give her a hand. And then our very first place goes to the smoked barracuda, Clyde.
Clyde,
come on, Clyde.
Clyde, Clyde, Clyde.
Yeah. I'm inviting him over for dinner to my house. That was good stuff right there. Then we actually had some folks ask about swinging a golf club today. Well, it was cold and wet out there. Not a lot of people got to it, but we have golf passes, and we're going to give those golf passes to Mr. Jonathan Vassaturo. He stayed out there and got close to the pin. And Mr. James Germano, give him a hand. Very, very good. And then our archery contest for our youth winner. We had a youth winner and an adult winner. I have that right, Brother Caleb?
Yes, sir.
Our youth winner for the archery contest is Courtney. Courtney, come on, give her a hand.
Yeah.
Did a good job. She came here to compete.
That's
she
right.
came here to compete, and she's going home with something. Very good. And our adult winner in the archery is Mr. Piercy. Come on down, Mr. Piercy. You're still here, Mr. John Piercy, right there. Grabbed a hold of that bow and kept saying, I'm not sure about this, and boom, hit the bullseye. I saw the whole thing. I wasn't sure about it, and I'm not even sure where it all landed out there, but I'm glad you did it. Very good. And then in our shooting contest, again, thank you, Brother Gary, and Brother John was out there helping him. Brother Dewey's out there helping him. All that went so well.
Amen.
Our youth winner, is this right here? Our youth winner is Mr. Nathaniel Gray. Nathaniel Gray. Is that true, Brother Dewey?
Yeah, you got two out of three.
He won it fair and square. Yeah. How about that? I'm impressed. He didn't get that from me. And our adult winner for our shooting contest out there. And Brother Gary, this is right. We've got it officially all by the book. And the winner is Mr. Dewey Cash. Give him a big hand. Very good. We got several gifts for everybody. Did you get a copy of that song sheet right there? With how great their art in it. In just a moment, and we're going to have Pastor Roger Pauly come and speak to us. And Carson, I'm going to tell you what, I'd like you to get a copy for me of that song. She would give it to you. I appreciate it. Thank you, buddy. We're going to sing this song together, all together, gentlemen. I know you sing well, especially after you had something good to eat.
Amen.
And so let's settle in for just a few moments. Pastor Roger Pauly's here all the way from Beckley, West Virginia, pastor of Cranberry Baptist Church. I'm glad to say he's been a friend of my dad's for many years, been a friend of mine for many years. And he loves the Lord. Him and his wife are in town. They'll be with us tomorrow here at Calvary. And they'll be helping us with Marriage and Family Sunday. If you're a married man, you know this. We always need help in our homes.
Amen.
Always need help.
Amen.
How blessed we are. We're going to be doing some homework tomorrow here at Calvary. And thank the Lord for that. How great thou art. We're going to sing a little bit of this together. And while Brother Caleb plays for just a moment there's a chapter in the Bible, a psalm that says, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. Who has set thy glory above the heavens? Out of the mouths of babes and sucklings hast thou ordained strength because of thine enemies, that thou mightest still the enemy and the avenger. In the Bible, the psalmist goes on to write, When I consider thy heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars which thou hast ordained. And he says this, What is man that thou art mindful of him? Aren't you glad that God's mindful of you? And then he takes it one step lower, And the son of man that thou visitest him. That's who we are. We're even one step lower. That's the Son of Man is something Jesus was called in the New Testament because he was the God-man. But it's no term that exalts any of us. But we're not much, but God is great. Amen? And I want you to sing it with me here. Let's sing all these verses together. We'll take special note of verse number 4. But in just a moment after we sing, we'll ask Pastor Paul to come along and speak to us whatever God's put on his heart. Let's sing together. Ready? Oh, Lord my God, we sound awesome. You sound good. I like the sound of that. Brother Paul, if you'll come along. Brother Paul has been our good friend and been a good encourager. I appreciate him and his wife being here this week, and I'm glad he's here to speak to us. He's from wild and wonderful West Virginia.
Amen.
He knows a little bit about the outdoors, but he knows the Lord. He's got a Bible. And he has something for us tonight. I want you to give him your undivided attention. Let's let the Lord have our attention for the next few moments. I appreciate you being here, sir. God bless you. Thank you.
Wow, this has been something tonight.
Amen.
And the food and some of the things that I didn't know exactly what I was having, but it was good. It was all good. And praise the Lord for it. It's good to be among some good men tonight. I've met several of you, young and old alike. And I met Charlie over here a little while ago, 83 years old. And he's visiting here. And what a blessing that is to see young and old to be able to come together. Amen. We want to look tonight in the book of Acts. As we talk about good men And I just want to read a couple of verses. There are a lot of good Bible characters when you get to studying them, whether it's Gideon or David or Joshua. And we can go through a list of those that are familiar characters in the Bible. And when we think about David coming up against Goliath, what a man that was, no doubt. But we find many of the Bible characters that we quote. We can quote Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and talk about these men and talk about their walk with the Lord and all of that. But there's one man that's mentioned in the Bible that there's no book named after him. He's mentioned a few times in the New Testament. But I want to call your attention tonight to a man as we find in Acts chapter 11. In Acts chapter 11, we come to a time when the church had been persecuted so much. The death of Stephen. How many deacons do we have in the room tonight? Let's see, from some church. Well, he's the first deacon to ever be stoned to death. And fortunately, in Baptist churches, there's not a lot of deacons being stoned, but maybe they could have been or should have been, but maybe they'd want to stone the pastor instead, right? But after Stephen's death, the church was persecuted beyond belief, and recognized that the Apostle Paul, who was Saul, that was leading the march to come against the church and persecuted those that were in the way, following that way of the Lord Jesus Christ. When we come to Acts chapter 11, we see that the church had grown so much because of persecution. It's an amazing thing how that God can take the worst of situations in our life, and because of persecution, they begin to separate, they begin to divide. And as they go out, they're winning more people to the Lord. And oftentimes we all go through things in our life that we don't understand, but God has a way of separating us from our family, or separating us from our home, or our what grounds we're familiar with, to go to another place, and again for the gospel to be spread. And that's the case in Acts chapter 11. When we see that the church of Jerusalem, they were quite concerned that now the gospel was going to the Greeks, not just to the Jews, but now to the Grecians. And so they put together a committee, and they called in who they think is best fit to go to Antioch and find out what this is all about and see if this is genuine. And so we come to Acts chapter 11, and in this passage of scripture, the Bible says, "And some of them were men of Cyprus and Cyrene, which when they came to Antioch, spake unto the Grecians, preaching the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Bible says, and the hand of the Lord was with them. And a great number believed and turned unto the Lord. Then tidings of these things came into the ears of the church which was in Jerusalem. And they sent forth Barnabas, and that he should go as far as Antioch." When I think about Bible characters, my favorite Bible character is the man by the name of Barnabas. And we find in this passage of scripture a description of this man. Why did they choose Barnabas? Now, we first hear of Barnabas in Acts chapter 4. And the Bible says that he was a Levite, and that when the apostles had preached, they were raising money. And he actually had land. As a Levite, he wasn't supposed to even have land. But the Bible says that he sold his land and brought the money and to the feet of the apostles that the gospel could be spread. We find in that passage that this man's name was actually Joses, J-O-S-E-S. But they changed his name because he was the son of consolation. He was an encourager. I've talked to some men tonight. I believe they're encouragers. Your pastor himself is an encourager. He's encouraged me. His daddy was an encourager to me and many other people. And don't you just like to be around men that are encouragers?
Amen.
I know a lot of guys, all they want to do is gripe and fuss and complain and put down everybody else. And if they couldn't talk about how bad everybody else was, they'd have nothing to say.
Yeah.
Truth.
Yeah.
But I like to be around people who love to lift people up.
Yeah.
The truth of it is, there's none of us in this room that are perfect. There's none of us in this room that have arrived. The Bible says in this passage of Scripture, verse 23, "Who, when he came," speaking of Barnabas, "had seen the grace of God and was glad and exhorted them all that with purpose of heart they would cleave unto the Lord." So here's a man that comes and finds that these Grecians, these Greeks, these Gentiles I'm glad the gospel came to the Gentiles. Amen. And so when he came, he recognized that indeed God had showed up. And he says again, the Bible says that he exhorted them all that they would cleave to the Lord, that they would draw closer to the Lord. And as you read this passage of scripture, it tells us why Barnabas was sent. I'm going to read this verse to you, and then I want you to think about it for just a few minutes, and then we're going to say it again. We're going to say it together. Here's why Barnabas was sent. Verse 24 of Acts 11. For he was a good man, full of the Holy Ghost and of faith, and much people was added unto the Lord. Now hear what it says. For he was a good man. Can you say that with me? For he was a good man. Do you know any good men? For he was a good man. And the Bible says, full of the Holy Ghost and faith. Let's say it. Full of the Holy Ghost and faith. And much people was added unto the Lord. And much people was added unto the Lord. I want to talk about this just for a few minutes, about these four things about this man by the name of Barnabas. And as I stand before you, men that I've never met, I would say that there's some men in this room that would fit this description. It would be my desire that it would be said of me one day that this was me. But you know, there are areas of my life that I recognize that I need to work on, and about being an encourager. Barnabas was called the son of consolation. Why? Because he was an encourager. Here we find he exhorted these men. And then it says in verse 24, the reason that he encouraged them, the reason that he was sent, for he was a good man, full of the Holy Ghost and faith, and much people was added unto the Lord. You know, the truth of it is, there's nothing more important in a man's life, young or old. And these young men need to hear this. They need to have some heroes other than those that are just in Hollywood. They need to have some heroes that understand what it is to be a man. What it is, again, to go out into the woods or to be a sportsman in some area and be fair about it. Look, oftentimes our kids, our grandchildren, they have heroes that we wouldn't want to pick for them to be our kids' heroes. But that's who they choose. There ought to be some heroes as Christians that we can be said of us that he's a good man. He's a good man. We think about Barnabas here. He was a man of character. I know a lot of characters, don't you? But he was a man of character. Do you know any people that were men of character? I think of my daddy. I think of your father. We were talking a little bit a while ago and talking about, no doubt, somewhere maybe their paths have crossed over the years. But men of character. But you know, this day there are a lot of men that care nothing about what their character says. But this was a man of character. And I give you this. The Bible says, first of all, he was a good man. You know what I get from that? He was a man who had a good conduct. Conduct on how he actually performed or how he acted in life. The noun for the word conduct is behavior, performance, deportment. His demeanor, how he presents himself. A man of character. I know men that you can't believe a thing they say. Do you know any men like that? How big was that fish? What about the one that got away? You know, men that you really can't trust. You believe that story? Let me tell you another good story. And these men that have these mounts, these trophies that are around these walls, no doubt they have some good stories that they can tell. But may I say, the most important thing, rather than telling some story, is that to be said of you after you're gone by your children or your grandchildren, he was a good man. He was a good man. But you see, good men do not go to heaven. And for our righteousness is as filthy rags. We're not saved by being good. We're saved by the grace of God. I'm glad as an 18-year-old boy that I placed my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. I, like Brother Greg, I was raised in a preacher's home. I tell them down to the house, I was raised on drugs. I was drugged to church on Sunday morning and Sunday night and Wednesday night, drugged to revival meetings and tent meetings and all of that when I was a kid. But when I was 14, 15, 16 years of age, I thought I finally arrived. I thought, you know, I know what this world's really all about. I never will forget when I got my driver's license and was able to get my first car and then to get a second car. And I was so proud of that car. It was a 69 Dodge Dart Swinger, 4-speed, 340, and the mic wheels and the Hurst shifter and a stripe around the back and all of that. And I thought I had the world by the tail on a downhill swing. But I want you to know, God changed all of that. We used to like to run them off. We'd go down to the little town I grew up in, born and raised in Bradley. We'd get down to the Bradley Market at the lighted sign all the way up to the First Baptist Church steps. Was a straight stretch of a quarter of a mile, and we just run them off late at night. But that all came to an end one time whenever I hit a car head on and God got my attention. And as an 18-year-old boy, even though I was raised in a Christian home, I had religion, but I knew nothing about a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah. And it was that time that I asked Christ to come into my heart, and He changed my life forever. I want you to know, you can be drugged to church and you can know a lot of religion. You can quote the Bible verses and sing the song. But the most important part, the thing that makes a person a good man, is the fact that he knows Jesus Christ as his personal Savior. Amen. Here is a man of character, but a man of conduct. And may I say, as a Christian, I recognize that we're epistles read of all men. People are watching our lives, and we must live the life. There's one thing to say I'm a Christian. There's another thing to not live the Christian life. And I promise you, I could talk to several of these men around these tables and around the room, that men that you work with or neighbors or family members that say they're a Christian, but they live like the devil. You don't need to call their names. They're everywhere. There's a lot of guys who have the talk, but they never have the walk. And there's a change in a person's life. When you come to know Christ as your Savior, 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new." I'm glad again that the Lord changed my life, and He changed it forever. But you know what? Once we come to know Christ as our Savior, the Lord wants us to keep growing in Him. And I recognize that from Matthew chapter 16, verse 24. And Jesus said, "If any man come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." You know what the Lord is saying to us all? He said, if you come to know Christ as your Savior, you come to Him. By the way, you'll find that word "come" 3,000 times in the Word of God. And most often, it is an invitation, the Lord inviting us to come. "Come now, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow." May I say tonight, the Lord invites us all to come. But once we come to know Christ as our Savior, He desires that we keep on coming. Deny ourselves, take up His cross, and follow Him. And the Lord says, once you start coming, you just keep on coming. And you follow me. And so I began to grow in the Lord, and the Lord began to speak to my heart. I was in business and sales for a number of years, and right in the middle of that, at the age of 32, my wife and I had been married 10 years, God called me to preach. I said I would never preach, but Mommy said, never say never. Yeah. And so I trusted Christ as an 18-year-old boy, answered the call to preach when I was 32, took my first church when I was 38, been at the same church now for 29 years. Come June of this year. And I want you to know, the Lord says to me, "Roger, you just keep on coming." Yeah. Keep on coming. We're never going to arrive. Now look, he was a good man. But wait a minute, the Bible goes on and says, "and was full of the Holy Ghost." Full of the Holy Ghost. You know what he's saying? The Holy Spirit, when we trust Christ, comes in and dwells within us. And let me just say this, and not to get off onto some doctrinal issue, but understand this, it's not how much of the Holy Ghost you have, it's whether the Holy Ghost has you. Yeah. And the Bible says he was full of the Holy Ghost, that we're yielding to the Holy Spirit. You know, I still battle the flesh. How about you? Yeah. There's still things that I want to say to people and just give them a piece of my mind. And my daddy used to say, and that's the problem with the world today, we give them too many pieces away. Yeah. And ultimately, we just, I'm just going to straighten him out. Well, whenever we yield to the Holy Spirit, and Mommy would say it like this, she said, "Roger, chew your words up before you spit them out. And count to 10, do something, yield to the Holy Spirit." Yeah. How many of us have said something, boy, you wish, oh, I wish I could take those words back. Yeah. But this was not a man that way. He was a good man. But it wasn't a good man because of himself, but what lived within him. Yeah. And the Bible says he was full of the Holy Ghost. It should not be your sport. It should not be your hobby. It should be the Holy Spirit. Now, all these other things are good. Amen. Thank God for it, that we can enjoy the journey. By the way, Jesus said, the thief, speaking of the devil, cometh not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But I'm come that you might have life, and that you might have it more abundantly. You know what the Lord's saying? I want you to enjoy the journey. I want you to enjoy all the creation. I want you to enjoy all the blessings of God. We can enjoy all of this. This is the abundant life. And keep in mind, the most important thing is eternal life. And eternal life does not begin the day that one dies. Eternal life began the day I trusted Christ as my Savior, or you placed your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And you have this gift of eternal life. And may I say, it's forever. I asked a little boy at bus meeting, Vacation Bible School, 1 year, rode the bus. And I had the opportunity to take the Bible and lead this little boy, 7 or 8 years old, to the Lord Jesus. And I asked the little boy when I read him John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And I asked the little boy, I said, what does this mean to you, everlasting life? And here's an 8-year old, never been in church, looked at the Bible, and he says, a life that lasts forever? And that's it. It's a life that lasts forever. The question is, are we going to enjoy the journey? Are we going to yield unto the Holy Spirit that lives within us? He was a man of conduct, a man controlled by the Holy Spirit. Look on, and the Bible says, and faith. He was not only one that was controlled by the Holy Spirit, but he was a man who had great confidence and relied upon the Lord Jesus Christ, trusting him and him alone. He was a man of faith. A man of faith. And the Bible said, for whatsoever is not of faith is sin. And there's no way to please God apart from faith. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We're all growing in the faith. Here's a man that went to Antioch to give a report for the church at Jerusalem. And the Bible says the reason that he was sent, because he was a man that was a good man, full of the Holy Ghost and faith. And then lastly, the Bible says, and much people was added unto the Lord. Here was a man of great conduct, a man who was controlled by the Holy Spirit, a man who had great confidence, not in himself, but in the Lord, in his faith. But he was also a man of compassion. Jude 22 says, some have compassion, making a difference. There's been some men in my life that's made a difference in my own life because of their compassion. A compassion on others. Caring about others. You see, the Apostle Paul was the man who was used by the Lord the most. We find over half of the New Testament written by the Apostle Paul. But guess who had the compassion enough to help the Apostle Paul? When you go to Acts chapter 9, you'll find that Saul, on the way again to Tarsus, a man of Saul of Tarsus, on the way again on the Damascus road to persecuting the Christians, come to know Jesus Christ as his Savior on that night. Amen. And the Bible says that the disciples were afraid of Paul. Even though his name was changed, his life was changed, they were afraid of him. But in Acts chapter 9, there was a man that took notice of who Paul was, and he interceded for Paul. His name was Barnabas. He was a man of compassion. On the other end of that, later there was John Mark that traveled with them. And there was much contention between Paul and Barnabas over John Mark, who went out on the mission field and decided, I want to go back home to mommy. So he goes back home. There was much contention. But we find that Barnabas reached out to Mark, gave him a second chance. And he was a man of compassion here at Antioch. And the Bible says, and much people was added unto the Lord. Why? Because here's a man, not only of great conduct, a man controlled by the Holy Spirit, a man who had great confidence in the Lord and his faith, and a man who had such compassion that much people was added unto the Lord. Thank God for all the trophies. Thank God for all the times that we can, whether it's golfing or hunting or fishing or whatever it may be. But you know, one day we're going to stand before the Lord. And the most important thing that we could ever be said of us
Well done, thou good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. Enter now into the joy of the Lord, and I'll make you ruler over many things. To hear the Lord say, well done. I don't know about you, Brother Greg, but I think I do know about you. I believe you as well, many others in this room. We desire to be a good man, to be full of the Holy Ghost and faith, and that much people would be added unto the Lord,
yes.
That many more would come to know Christ.
We have some giveaways, and then we have some big gifts tonight. We're going to have a big drawing for a youth, and we have an $85 gift card, I think, to Bass Pro for a young person tonight. And then we have a black powder gun, a muzzle loader, CBA muzzle loader for a giveaway for our adult men tonight. And I think that's why some of you are here. God bless you. And we're able to get over to thank God. Our friends at Wilcox Bait and Tackle were able to help us with that the other day. And we're going to work together on this tonight. And we're going to call out some names. And as we call your name, we have some giveaways on the table. And make sure you get some of that before you leave this evening. And Brother Ruben, you're going to help us out too. That's wonderful. Thank you so much. And so let's work on it here tonight. Brother Caleb, what do we have on the end there? We've got some gifts here. We're going to have to know what we have. We've got an oil change, and we'll get that to one of our men here or one of our adults in the room. And we will, you can give me any one you want. We'll take this one right here. Try to expedite as much as we can. John Richardson, come on down and get that one, my friend. Give him a big hand. We've got another oil change gift certificate to Travis's Auto Repair. Not just any place, but Travis. How many know Travis does a good job? And he's a good fella. We love their family. Mike Burton, from over in Hampton. Come on and get this. What do I have here? Oh, sheer success. Every once in a while, we need a haircut, don't we? I'm needing it less and less all the time, but I'm working on it. I'm trying to grow some more hair. We're going to give this one to Mr. Kenneth Hayes from over in Hampton. Come on, man. Yeah, come on. There you go. Look at here now. Come on, we've got something from Best Cuts. Something that'll make you look good and smell good. That's a whole lot of looking good and smelling good right there. What name can we get in there? Who are we going to get this to tonight? Looks like we're going to give this to David Short up in Yorktown. Come on, David. Yeah. That's a man just got his prayers answered right there. So we got a nice sweatshirt here. I think you'll enjoy it. Thank you, Brother Ruben. Penny Brown from over Newport News. We got a camo hat here. Visor going to Phil Sherman. Another one of these visors here going to Mr. Joe Jacob in the kitchen. Look at there. Joe, this will look good on you, my friend. Go hand that to him back there. That's good. How many of you want to see Brother Joe put that on right now?
Amen.
Come on. Now look here. There he is.
All right.
Hey, listen, we love Brother Joe. We'd never get the heat around here if it wasn't for him. Very good. We're going to give this package here. Oh, yes. One of our good friends, Mr. James Goodwin. Come on. Would you take that? Now, if you don't know Mr. James Goodwin, you're missing out. He's one of the best men God ever created right
Amen.
There. He's a good fellow. We've got another package of gifts here. This Cabela's bag and a little drink holder there for Lynn Parker from over in Hampton. Come on, Lynn. Not bad.
Good to see you again.
Appreciate it. We got another one of these bags for Bill King from Newport News. Bill. This side of the room is ramping up. You guys are on the right side. Very good. Now look, this is my favorite thing that's here. There's a rubber band blaster right there. How many of you know that's a lot of fun right there? If you get this, if you're from Calvary Baptist Church, do not bring this to the worship service tomorrow, all right? Oh, well, you could. I'm not going to be preaching. This man will be preaching. So, but anyway, that's between you and the Lord. Who can we give this to here? One of these, maybe this is a, is this a young fellow? Young person, can we trust a young person with a rubber band blaster? Is everybody in favor of giving this to a young person?
No.
Can we trust them? We're going to give this one to Luke from up in Yorktown. Luke, come on and get this thing. I don't know, Mike. You better watch him. Better watch him. Keep your eyes on him right there. That's good. That is, if I could get one thing tonight, that would have been it right there. $50 off lawn service or repair of $125 or more. That's going to Mr. Jeff Rosenbaum. This is Copher Auto. What do we got in here? Take the oil change. The Copher's, that will go to Mike Ellis. Yeah, Mike, we're right ahead. There's a family pass to the YMCA. That's going to Ronnie Munden from over in Chesapeake, People's Baptist Church. Fishing runner, give me another name and we'll give it to somebody. How about your cousin, Ryan Boyd? How about you, Ryan? Very good. He ain't, look, he's not going to re-gift it.
I'll get it.
Walker will take it. All right, what else we got? Okay, now we're down to the end where we have a grand prize for a youth tonight. That's $85 to Bass Pro, is that correct? And that's pretty nice. In fact, someone donated that to us for this purpose. And I think it was donated by Brother Marion Martin. Very good. He took care of that. We'll have a name for that for one of our young people. And tonight, the grand prize for a young person, teenager, and youth for $85 to Bass Pro is Mr. Timmy Seitz. Timmy Seitz. All right, and then we got the CVA muzzleloader here, gentlemen. And right here, we got it from over Wilcox Bait and Tackle. And that's going to go here to our grand prize, as we do every year. And we want to let you take a good look at it here while these guys are drawing our name. It's going to go to one of our men here in the room. Let's find a name for that here tonight, if we could. Gentlemen, if we could. Drum roll, please. The preacher's going to pick it. A little drum roll. And the grand prize for the 2019 Sportsman's Bank here at Calvary Baptist Church. The muzzle loader goes to Stephen Borst from Smithfield, Virginia. Stephen. We're trying to encourage folks. We're trying to encourage people to follow the Lord Jesus Christ and try to help people any way we can. And I'll be honest with you, I wish we had a room full of 10,000 men to hear what we've heard tonight and experience what we experienced. They'd be helped, just like we are, to go home and be the man God's called us to be. And again, I'm glad for everybody that's here. Appreciate our friends visiting with us. Let's stand together. We'll have a word of prayer. We'll be dismissed. Let's give a big hand to the guys that are working in the kitchen. Get your lunch. Now, while we were outside running around, they were inside organizing all the food. Now, the men in our church bring food and put all this together, but these men organize all of it. And we do it because we love doing this. This is something, again, that my dad loved so much. Maybe his favorite meeting all year long was this meeting. He really enjoyed it. And we miss him, but I know he's enjoying heaven. And he's glad that he's there with Mama, and they're with the Lord. Listen, I tell you what, leave behind a clear testimony. You want to know what helps me as their son? To know that they're with the Lord.
Yep.
That's what helps me. That's why I can stand up and talk to you about it. That's why I can stand up and preach and still sing and do some of the other things. If I didn't know that, I'd have a hard time carrying on. So if I can give you a piece of friendly advice, leave a clear testimony that you love God through Jesus Christ and live that out, and that'll be the best gift you ever give your family. I'm enjoying that gift in my grief, and it's helping me in a wonderful way. I want to do that for my kids and my wife. May God help us all. Amen?
Amen.
Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer.